the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, and you may be seated. Christiansburg Town Council is now in session. You have a copy of the minutes of the last meeting. I hope you've had an opportunity to read over those, and we'll entertain a motion to accept the minutes.
I so move.
Second. Motion and a second to accept the minutes as presented. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. Thank you. This is a portion of our meeting where we hear comments from citizens. And this evening we have on the agenda Mr. Andy Shack, who will be speaking to us about a noise ordinance. It's always good to see you again, Andy. Mr. Andy Shack.
Good evening, and thank you for your time. The concern I'm bringing before council today deals with a nuisance, a noise ordinance that currently is exempt due to the zoning of industrial. I would be requesting that we make an amendment to that nuisance noise disturbance due to the fact that Chandler Concrete used to run night runs every once in a blue moon when Steve Marshall owned it. If you look at the, I put several things in front of you. The satellite picture. Marshall Concrete used to be across the railroad tracks back when Jack Bye started that business. Steve Marshall and Mr. Canada expanded that business, bringing the noise and the nuisance and the dust closer to the residential people when they built that tower. Now, the design of the tower was a little bit beneficial to the public because when they designed it, the loading of the concrete is actually on the back side of the tower. So when they do rev up the trucks, that are very large trucks, majority of the noise is dampened, but you can still hear them. Since then, if you come down your sofa, and I'm not an artist, here's the tower, and if you're looking at your satellite picture, when you come off Yellow Sulk Road, there's a second entrance. They put up a new little staging area, even closer to the residential people. And that's those two photographs you see in front of you, those metal towers. And what they do is, let me back up for just a second. I called Bob and Ted Chandler in North Carolina, the owners of the business. And he sent a young man named Brent Queen, which is sitting here this evening, to my house. And I agreed to that. Because I wanted to resolve this in a diplomatic, civil way and try to be a neighbor. Well, Bob Chandler assured me that he is community-oriented and that he wanted to work with us. I said, that's great. I said, because Steve Marshall was. Steve Marshall didn't run nearly a third of the runs that Chandler's running at night. And when I say night, I'm talking midnight on, these trucks are rolling. Steve and Dan Canada and David Stallings would offer hotel rooms, accommodations to people who had issues with the noise, because they knew it was an issue. And how you know for a fact, my best witness is Dan Canada. He's not even here. In front of you, I put the minutes from October 6, 2009, town council meeting where Dan Canada actually got up and spoke against Boxley, something Christiansburg. Because, and I highlighted the section I wanted you guys to read, but he stressed that the request is a matter of common sense. And he's right. Dan Canada is absolutely right. Noise will be an issue to nearby homes and businesses. He's right. It's a a terrible nuisance. Dust will be an issue for nearby homes and businesses, and he's right. We got plenty of dust. But I'm not worried about the dust. I can wash my car. But my girls are staying up all night and they're sleeping all day in class, and you're affecting my children's education. It's a health, safety, and educational issue. Again, it's a matter of common sense. So I think when Dan and Steve built the addition to the business, they had in mind the community, because they actually reached out. They would call me. They told several other people in the community, hey, we're running a nightclub. Need a hotel room? Or do you want to go to your mom and dad's, take your kids? But the problem I have with Chandler, it's becoming a 24-hour service, practically. I explained the same thing that Steve and Dan Canada did for me. So Grant Queen would send me emails on when they're running. The week before last, it says, just heads up, we're having calls from 1 a.m. and 2 a.m. Tuesday through Friday, all week. Upcoming week, hey Andy, we're running Friday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, starting at 1 a.m., 3 a.m., 1 a.m., 1 a.m., and 12:15 a.m. So I ask you, when do my kids have time to sleep? And at what price do we put on education? And Mayor, you know all about education. It's important. My kids have to have it. One of the big reasons I'm here is to fight on behalf of my children. Me, I can drink coffee and get through the day. But my kids can't, and you're affecting my children. So I met with Brett. Brett came to my house and explained all the issues we were having, the noise, the trucks, the jake breaking, the whole nine yards that goes along with the concrete. So I asked him, I said, hey, can you take that metal stand that you see there is where they put the metal fibers into the trucks. After they load at the tower and drive around the front of the business, they pull back into the parking lot right beside the residential community, even the closest you can get to our homes. And they have to rev those trucks up wide open to turn that concrete. While the guys climb up that little tower, dump the bags of metal into the mixture, and then they drive back around the building and head out. My question would have been, which I didn't get the opportunity, because on Wednesday, the 29th of August, I called the police department because I thought it was an alarm, a noise I never heard before. I went over there, the officers over there, Brett Queen showed up. There's a tractor trailer where they pumped the cement into the towers. Makes an awful whine. So Brett shows up and he boldly said that he read the website in Christiansburg, and he clearly says, I'm zoned industrial. I have an exemption to the noise. I'll do what I want. I gotta go do business. And he walked off. And I said, that's fine. You can chase that dollar. And I knew at that point right then and there that I didn't have a business that really truly cared about the community. They don't care if I sleep, they don't care if my kids sleep, and they don't care if they affect my children's education. I knew right then and there I was going to do something about it. So I'm here. I went to planning. As you can see, I got how the property was zoned. I want you to look at the two. This is Chandler Concrete. Backs right up to residential. Not close, not nearby homes, like Dan Canada said in 2009. We're talking on top of the homes. And each and every one of you are invited to stay at my house. I will feed you a complimentary breakfast in the morning to come listen to the noise. Where Boxley wanted to come was industrial and business with residential way over here. With a road that is zoned industrial, so they would not be disturbing anybody. So if Dan Canada felt that strong that he had to come and speak against Boxley in an industrial law about the noise, the excessive noise, what do you think we feel like when you're sitting in our back door with a 3.5-4 inch exhaust pipe wide open all night long to mix concrete? Something's got to be done. So I said, okay, I got to find out who's creating this noise. They're selling the product because they're in for the money, not the people. I said, I'm going to find out. So I did. Went to Virginia Tech. Found four professors, Andrew McCoy, Bruce Ferguson, Gerald Hoffman, and Lecter. They are over the Department of Capital Design and Construction. These four men, these doctors, professors, take care of all the building that goes on at Virginia Tech. I expressed my concerns to them, and they said, whoa. Virginia Tech doesn't want any part of that. We are definitely community-oriented. We're sorry that the product that they're purchasing from Chandler is causing such a ruckus among the community. And I said, yeah, it keeps me up, but more importantly, you're affecting my children's education. I've got a serious problem with that. They assured me, they said, well, this was never mentioned to them. And they assured me that they were going to get with the general contractors from here on out at Virginia Tech. And they would change the times in which they're going to order the concrete. And my question is, why is somebody like Virginia Tech that makes Chandler look like a small fish in a fishbowl, they're willing to work with the community. But Chandler, it's obvious they don't. Because no one's come to my door, my phone hasn't rang since. We still got the Jake break-in, we still got the all-night pause. Something's got to be done. So these guys are going to change, and they asked me if I'd have a problem running from like 5 p.m. to 11 p.m. I said, absolutely not. Run yourself to death. Start at 6 in the morning, run yourself to 11 p.m. That's more than enough time to sell and do what you got to do with concrete around this town. There's no need to be running at 1 a.m. in the morning. Unless you have certain specs. I do deal with concrete in my job. And I know that sometimes with a bridge deck, you don't want to pour in 90 degree weather with the sun beating down. It dries out the concrete. It doesn't cure correctly. I understand concrete. But what they're doing at Tech, and these professors assured me, there's no need that they need to be, they don't need the concrete at 1 a.m. in the morning. That they can alter that. So, Chandler doesn't want to work with me, that's fine. I've worked for town council. I'm asking for an amendment. We also have a speed issue on Block Street, and I know there's several other residents here that have issues with that. If they want to get up and speak, that's fine. It doesn't directly affect me, but it's directly in front of their door. I know they have a problem with the Jake breaking, and I do too. I called last night at 3:45 a.m. in the morning. And I'm going to tell everybody here, I drive heavy equipment for a living. It's a simple switch on your dashboard, on, off. That's very inconsiderate. I've asked Brett to tell the drivers quit it, and here we are a month later and we still got a problem. So I'm asking for an amendment to the noise ordinance to regulate some of the hours in which they operate. Again, they got plenty of time to sell concrete, 6 a.m., 11 p.m. If that doesn't work, I also put a brochure in there for a sound barrier wall. I don't know if the town can absorb that kind of cost or Chandler can, but they make sound barrier walls now, guaranteed to stop that noise from coming over into the residential area. Put that baby up the old Topher Road, separate industrial from residential. Third option is invite Boxley back to Christiansburg. If they got so much work that they have to work 24/7, like Walmart, then surely we got enough work that Boxley can come in here and take half the load off them so they can work normal business hours and the citizens of Christiansburg can get a good night's rest and my children can obtain a good education instead of sleeping in class and have to be a teacher. Those would be my three recommendations to the town council.
Hey, thank you, Andy. Questions for Mr. Shay?
I have just one. I take it you have talked to other neighbors that live around you?
Yes, sir. I just talked to the need. I didn't have much time to put this presentation together. But if there is a few in here, and if they choose to speak, that's their choice. And if they don't, I'll be the ugly man. That's fine.
So you don't have any kind of signed documents about different people who have... who would support this or support you, or they also think it's a problem?
How many others do you want to hear from?
I don't know.
I mean, do you want me to get a petition? I mean, do we have to go to that extent? I would hope not. I mean, you got Dan Canada, ex-town councilman, been on several boards in this town, his own business, telling you it's a nuisance, common sense. And I'm sure everybody sitting behind a desk is pretty intelligent people.
Did this situation exist, Andy, when the other people owned that company? Did they make the concrete at night like Chandler's doing?
No. Steve Marshall and Dan Canada and David Stolz did run night runs. But it was, most of that concrete that was being poured was temperature sensitive, bridge decking, stuff to that fashion. But the difference between them and Chandler is Steve and Dan and David would come to me or email, like Brett did. I give it up to Brett. He does email me, but that doesn't help the situation. None. And they would try to make accommodations. Steve Marshall has offered me personally, put me up in a hotel anytime he ran night shift, but it was maybe 8 runs a summer. It's been a lot this summer, non-stop. Well, the last two weeks, just about full time.
You mentioned these professors at Virginia Tech.
Yes, sir.
Virginia Tech is not their only customer, are they?
No, sir, it's not. But these night pours are going to Virginia Tech. Because they clarified that for me. Yes, they've got several jobs going on. And a lot of them, because they're pouring the columns and the floor slab all at once. And it takes a lot of concrete. And that is some of their jobs. I mean, but they don't have a problem working with us. And I'm thankful for that. But Virginia Tech, Virginia Tech. And you know how politics and money goes.
Mm-hmm. What's your address, Mr. Shack?
It's 485 Pickett Street. Right there at the cul-de-sac. Okay. And that tower, that metal tower that they do the metal fibers, is, I mean, you know, more than probably 60 yards from my front door. You're talking wide open. And all I did is, he has a recommendation, and I know Brett's sitting here, so maybe he can think about this. Instead of loading at the tower and driving out here on your old sofa and over here right next to residential to put in your metal fiber, why don't you open up this gate right here? This is nothing but parking. Put your little tower over here. They can load, make a right-hand turn, make a left, load the fiber. There's two buildings, if you look at your geographical map here, the satellite, there's two buildings that would be a natural buffer for the noise of the truck to the residents over here. And then there's also a gate that they can come back out on the main road. And to me, that's a much simpler right turn, left turn, you're out on the main road, then load, go in a circle, load, go in a circle, and come back out. But what do I know? You know, I just have an associate, that's all.
Who's been your primary point of contact, Mr. Shack, throughout this with Chandler?
Mostly with Bob Chandler. I mean, Brett, I've talked to Brett twice. One was not so pleasant, one was pleasant. One, he came to my house and promised me he was going to do what he could to lower the noise. And
What's Brett's last name?
Queen.
And to explain to somebody like me who doesn't know about heavy equipment, what is jack braking?
Jake braking, it's an exhaust brake. The engine basically brakes the vehicle for you so you don't have to use your brakes. That's primarily used when you're using slope. The issue we have is Cambria Street from North Franklin, their plan is practically flat. The problem you have is when it's flying in, which there is some residents here that have an issue with speed. They come in and just about the water tower, boom, all the way to the plant. And I'm thinking, if you're going that fast on a flat plane that you need an exhaust brake, you got a problem.
I understand now.
Okay. It's just basically it's
like using a lower gear to slow you down.
Right. The engine does it for you instead of your brakes. And primarily it's for slopes. It's not for level plane. But the speeds, I mean, that's another option we have. The town, why don't you reduce the speed limit right there and block to 15? And we'll put a patrol car, and when it comes flying down through there, it'll start writing tickets. Last time I checked, I didn't think you can jake-break in residential area. And if you look at the map, half residential, half business, not industrial.
Any suggestions, counsel?
You know, I seem to recall that we had the same problem with jake-breaks at another location, the Hans, back up behind the Hans Meadow Inn, and they were coming down in the morning. We not stop that?
No. We had changed ordinances on that.
But we've met with the builder, because the problem seemed to subside. I mean, no, we didn't change any ordinances, but I think we did meet with the builder, and he met with his contractors, and that subsided quite a bit. Is that your recollection, Randy?
I believe so. I think it's been a few years ago, obviously.
We had any complaints lately, huh?
No.
We had some complaints on South Franklin Street for a while also.
I appreciate you coming to council with some sketches and some planning, and you articulated very well, I think, what your concern is. Also, not to put anyone on the spot, but that's what I'm doing. I do see some folks that I believe, at least one that I believe is associated with Marshall Concrete.
Chandler Concrete?
Chandler, excuse me. Is there anything we're going to hear from you this evening or not? After Mr. Shack, after we're done? Okay. Well, I would appreciate hearing both sides of the coin.
One more thing I forgot. I researched Chandler has a plant in Dublin, which this was forced by the professors. This was the professor's idea. Being that this plant is not in the residential area, and you can pass around and look, it's very secluded. Granted, Chandler would have to probably pay, I don't know, $15 more in gas to get the concrete from that plant to the tech. The professors wanted me to throw that out there on the table to the council too, maybe address that issue then. They have another plant 15 more minutes away, but why not run out of a plant where there is no residential versus residential?
And I guess to be specific, I'll get right to the point. In the comments that have been made, I'm very interested in any changes in regular operations from, say, 5 years ago till today. Because if there are other residents here, that seems to be a salient point with me, is what have been changes that have been made to general operations. But anyway, just I would appreciate hearing some talk about that.
And you say there are folks here in the audience that live in that area. Okay, I wonder if you could give us a show of hands. Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. So you're speaking for the neighborhood. That gives us some.
Yeah, and like I said, I didn't canvass the whole neighborhood, and I didn't do the proposal thing because I don't feel like I need to. Mm-hmm. Because Dan Canada, my best witness, on paper, black and white, says it very clearly, it's commonsensical. We need our sleep, our kids need a good education, and it's a matter of health, safety, and education. It's not about the dollar here. And I'm not saying they can't run their business, but surely they can shut down at 11 p.m. and start at 5. You're only talking 6 hours out of 24 hours.
I can recall in some of our conditional use permits that we put a restriction on hours of operation to cut down on noise. Evidently, industrial zoning doesn't require...
There is no conditional use permit for Chandler.
But there's nothing in our ordinance, our noise ordinance, that speaks to industrial noise.
It specifically exempts industrial uses
across the board.
You're thinking about section one, you know, Mr. Shack.
I'm sorry.
Sounds generated in business, industrial, and mixed-use zoning districts that are necessary and incidental uses permitted therein. It's the very first section under exemptions. That's the one you're referring to, I take it.
I'm looking for an amendment. I mean, it's a changing of the times here. Business used to be the way business was back in the old days. We need to look out for the citizens, too. I understand that town makes a lot of revenue off this company. No doubt about it. It's a business. you got to take the citizens of Christiansburg into consideration as well. And when I bought my property, that tower was even there, where it was built, and they worked with us, and had no problem with it. And they didn't run all the time at night, and had no problem with it. I'll live beside them today when the sun's up. But you know, we need our sleep. It's natural. It's healthy. You got to have so many hours of sleep. Body's got to recuperate.
How many days a week do you hear the noise after midnight, after 1 o'clock in the morning, Mr. Shack?
I'm sorry.
How many days per week, on average, have you been hearing this noise after 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock?
Just about all summer. I mean, the last 2 weeks, it's been Tuesday through Friday.
Is this something that kind of started up at the beginning of the summer or late spring, or has it just been consistent for quite a while now?
It started up at the beginning of the summer, and I think Brett checked with Scott, Canada, at one time and said it was going to be several pours at night. I'm thinking, okay, a handful. It's pretty consistent. But Tech did assure me that their projects are about ready to come to an end. Probably by Friday, one of the buildings. See, they allot 3 to 4 buildings a year to build on their budget. So they forecasted me to let you know that for the next X amount of years, you're looking at 3 or 4 buildings that need to be poured. But they also assured me that they were going to get with Chandler and say, if you're the company that we choose to buy our product from, that it would be ran from like 5 p.m. to 11 p.m. instead of 1 a.m. when people are trying to sleep. Like I said, you're all welcome. I'll make you scrambled eggs and toast in the morning. Or open up your house and I'll come sleep with you guys. It don't matter.
Andy, you've made a very logical and good presentation. And I'm not sure what action we can take. We'll discuss it here. Do we have a recommendation from planning or from the town manager?
At this point, Mr. Okay.
Have you discussed this problem with the town?
Yes, sir. I followed the steps. First, I approached the business to be a neighbor. And when I knew, when you show me that you're not cooperating with me, and you really have no due regard for me or my family or the citizens in my community, I'm going to step up. And everybody knows in here how Andy Shack is, I'm going to step up. And I am. So then I said, okay, I'm going to the town. First place I went was planning. Find out what the zoning was. I found out what the code read. And I went to the police department, chief of police. I said, listen, Mark, we go way back. And I said, coming to you before I go to town council. We got a problem with these trucks, Jake, breaking. We got a problem with the speed. You get over there and do your job, and I won't make you look bad. And you appreciate that. So the town and the police department got together and realized the issue at hand had to go before town council. Because the only way we would resolve this issue is an amendment to noise ordinance.
Thank you.
I might say that, when did you give me a call? About 10 days ago or a week?
Yes, sir.
And he wanted to call up everybody on council, as I recall. And I'm not sure why it was. And he talked to each one of us independently. And I recommended to him that it might be easier and he could do a better job if he just did what he's doing right now. So he did, sir.
I'm called a couple of you guys. I'm not here to make a stink. I'm not here to, you know, put down the town. I'm just saying we need sleep. I can't say it any simpler. My kids need to sleep. I'm a father, and my job as a father is to protect my children. And I'll do what I have to protect my children. So I'm here.
All right, thank you, Andy.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to address council at this time? Give state your name, sir, and address your comments directly to council.
Yes, sir. My name is Brett Queen. I am the general manager of Chandler Concrete, Virginia. Do appreciate the opportunity. And, you know, we're not the terrible guys around the corner. I would love nothing more than for us to operate from 5 a.m. to 6 p.m. in the evening. Tickle me to death. We've got guys working crazy hours you know, dog tired, just, you know, running to death. But I'm here to tell you, we don't dictate when we work. We completely work off of specifications set forward by these projects. It's not just Virginia Tech. It's the city of Blacksburg. It's the New Auburn High School. We've got VDOT work. There are several projects that require certain temperature specifications on ready-mix concrete. That's why in the summer times you see us operating at these crazy hours so often, because we've got to maintain certain temperatures to meet these requirements. You know, to be able to operate later times in the evening, the problem with that is your materials heat up during the day, and you cannot maintain those lower temperatures of the concrete late in the evening. It sounds crazy, but you know, as the temperature starts decreasing after 6, 7, 8 o'clock in the evening, it still takes several hours for a material to cool down enough where we can get it cooler with things like chilled water and ice to maintain the temperatures that are required. I did meet with Mr. Shack at his home, and I spoke to him a time or two on the phone, and I did tell him that we would do everything we could to try to minimize the disruptions that we're creating. We have spoken with all of our drivers. We have material coming into our location to resupply our stockpile so we can continue to make the concrete. And no, we probably have not reached each and every driver that comes into our location about the J-brakes. But I can assure you that we have spoken with all of our guys. We've got signs posted all over our doors letting the guys know to turn your J-brakes off. Not all of our trucks are even equipped with J-brakes, but several of them do have them. And we are certainly trying to get everybody to shut those things off coming down Cambria. The issue with the loading of the steel fibers that Mr. Shack mentioned, we do have the tower out front, and after Mr. Shack and I met at his home, he expressed the concern, the loud noise from the trucks revving up over there. What we did do after that point was we still had to load the material into the trucks at that location. But instead of revving the trucks up at full speed to get the proper mix, instead of doing that at that point, we revved it up just enough to get the material introduced down into the drum. We then would bring our trucks around the back, finish mixing the material up behind the plant, just as he had said earlier. It does kind of buffer the sound back there. So we have done that. We may have only used that material one time since that night, as far as any pours that we've had. Those come and go. That's just, again, a matter of the specifications. What do they dictate goes in the mix as far as reinforcing. Interesting note, I used to be in a rock band, and sound and noise levels was a concern for us because of the places that we play. So I'm very familiar with sound and the effects and decibel meters. And actually, I own a decibel meter. So last week, when Mr. Shack called the police on the new noise he was hearing, I think he thought it was an alarm going off. So I brought the decibel meter with me just to see what kind of levels we're getting. I set out that morning from 2:30 a.m. to about 2:10 to about 2:45, just taking readings. Where I was located was at the stop sign at the end of the street. I'm not sure what the name of the street is.
Jackson
Street. I was at the stop sign. I would estimate that's probably 100 to 110 yards from his house, closer to our plant. The decibel readings that I got, for instance, a ready-mix truck that was coming down Cambria to the plant empty read about 70 decibels. A truck, a loaded truck leaving our plant got up to about 72 decibels. A little more weight, a little more torque to get the truck up the road, so obviously it's going to be a little bit louder. Concrete being batched at the plant, it ranged from 60 to 62 decibels during that process. Trucks leaving our exit gate at the lower end was about 65 decibels. By the time we reached the upper end, they varied between 69 and again 72 decibels. A pickup truck coming down Cambria with normal stock exhaust. He did not have dual exhaust or glass packs or anything like this. It was a normal Ford pickup, 68 decibels when he came by where I was sitting. And we did have a few moments where it was actually totally quiet from an industrial standpoint. The plant was not running. There were no trucks. There was no traffic. The crickets in the neighborhood, 58 to 60 decibels.
Mr. Quinn, are you telling us that then that there's not loud noises emitted from
these
trucks?
I'm not saying we're not making noise. We are. I'm just stating that in perspective from the levels that I got from the decibel meter and the readings, we're just a few decibels higher than a pickup truck going down Cambria. Now, I'm not saying that you know, to minimize the issue. Like I said, I would love nothing more than for us to be able to operate under normal hours. You know, I know it's hard on neighbors and it's hard on our guys too. But the fact is, you know, Mr. Shack made a great statement, and it's true. Changing of the times. 10 years ago, we didn't have the specifications that we have now. 5 years ago, we didn't have the specifications we have now. They're more stringent, they're tighter, and they're tougher to maintain. And as a company, we're trying to do what we can to service the customers, to create the job, to be good neighbors, and sometimes it just doesn't all work together. I'm sorry, I hate that. I don't like being a bad neighbor. We don't certainly set out to be a bad neighbor. I just, at this point, I don't know what else we can do to quieten things down. Now, certainly, this is the first I've heard of a speed issue, and I will certainly address that with our plant managers and our plant operators over there and our production manager to make sure our guys are following the posted speed limits over there. And we will continue to tell our folks to not use their Jake brakes coming down that road, because he's absolutely right, it's not needed. It's not needed to come down that stretch of road to use your Jake brake. And we will continue to talk with our material suppliers, our guys, and get them to make sure and flip that switch off before they hit Cambria Street.
What are you, as a company, willing to do to enforce that? I mean, you can talk to your guys, mm-hmm. but do you go out and catch them yourself?
Right.
I mean, it doesn't do anything.
Right. I mean,
I think there needs to be some self-patrol mm-hmm. on your part, on okay. the company's part. If you're going to require this, then maybe you need to go a little further than putting a sign on the door for the vendors.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you need to contact all of the vendors that service you and let them know this.
And we have done that. The problem is they contract out and then they contract out, so sometimes you don't get the same guys coming in. I don't think it's near what it was, say, a month ago. I do believe that the J-Brake issue has cut down significantly. But we will continue to meet with our vendors to make sure that's taken care of.
Look, but one truck coming through with a J-Brake at 2 o'clock at night is going to wake you up, right?
Right.
What about, you mentioned earlier, a minute ago, that said, I think about 30 days ago, it was a lot more of a, I guess, more numerous loads, more numerous runs being made at odd hours.
Mm-hmm.
Is there truth to what Mr. Shack is saying, that this has been pretty consistent throughout the summertime?
Yes.
And how many, when you say consistent, I mean, how many times are we talking, just to give me a rough estimate?
It just depends. We're so weather-related as far as what we can do, what the job sites can take. It could be 5 days a week. It could be 1 day a week. If I had to say there was an average, I would say it's probably been an average of 3 days a week, maybe four. But I think three is closer to it.
And that would be after the 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock time frame?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
And you said earlier that the concrete, it depends on obviously the job you're doing.
Correct.
And whether or not you have, it's temperature sensitive.
Yes, sir.
Are all of those temperature sensitive jobs that are being
yes,
undertaken? Every
yes,
one of those?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All those are high spec jobs that, temperature specs on concrete usually between 85 and 90 degrees.
So I take it that none of those that are going to Tech then, for instance, if they're not temperature related as with the professors, I guess that's been brought to our attention today, none of those will be servicing Tech in the odd hours?
Yeah, all the there were several jobs at Tech. I know Mr. McCoy, I've met with him several times over the summer over different things that we've been working on. I've not received a phone call from him or an email concerning changing any of the pour times or the pour schedules. Just about, I think, two of the pours that we've got scheduled for this week are at Tech.
And I guess, in just looking at the aerial view, I'm referring to this map here, I'm sure you've seen things like this, or probably this one in particular. Chandler is, I mean, the reality is it's kind of an odd placement, being so close to residential area, correct?
You know, this was placed in
sure.
long before Chandler bought it, long before I've been here.
Okay. There's been some expansion in the years, correct?
Well, the concrete plant that you see now, I think, was built, Scott, do you know?
1999 to 2000.
Around 2000, the concrete plant was built.
And this over the, I guess that's a railroad line there, but over that line, that's been some additions in that area, is that
correct?
That's
the block facility.
Okay.
They manufacture
that's the block facility.
Yes, sir.
I guess the question I have is that you mentioned that you've done everything that you could. You said we've done everything that we could do. And I believe you said that those pours that are temperature sensitive happen during the summer months, which would be late spring to early fall,
yeah,
correct?
Yeah, you know, we've had a very unusual warm summer this year. It's been one of the hottest on record, I believe. Mm-hmm. You know, that's a definite contributing factor to all this.
Has it ever been brought up, I mean, in essence of being a good neighbor, to erect sound barriers, things of that sort?
No, sir.
Has that ever been talked about, or
no, sir.
Is that an option that Chandler has on the table?
I can't answer that. We would have to talk to the owners concerning that.
Something you're willing to do?
We've certainly talked with the owners about that.
And I think you mentioned that you have another plant in Dublin?
Correct.
What do you think about his idea?
We have run out of that plant before going to Tech and those jobs. Not only do we have temperature specifications, but there's time specifications. And the further away you are, the more difficult it is to meet those specifications on job sites. The Dublin plant is a smaller plant, does not produce the amount of concrete that the Christiansburg plant can produce. So it's just not a feasible location to be a main supplier for these early morning pours. Mostly because of time, getting there in the correct amount of time, giving them the time they need on the job site to place the concrete.
But you can't be pouring this stuff early at 6 o'clock in the morning, can you?
Oh, yes.
You are pouring early now?
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
So do you estimate a time, weather terms called, this is going to stop?
It won't stop completely, but it will slow down. Typically, late September, sometimes mid-September, it starts winding down.
Is the noise coming from the actual mixing of the concrete, or is the noise just coming from the trucks?
It's the trucks.
So it's the trucks.
They have to rev up their trucks and turn that barrel while they're loading.
Okay.
And that steel thing, again, I even offered my services to them. I'll unbolt that thing and drag it with my pickup truck to the other side of those two buildings across the railroad track. And all the driver has to do is make a right turn, make a left turn, load his stuff, and go back on the road.
Well, see, then we have to come back because we have a certain area that we've got to wash the trucks down in to maintain our environmental standards that we've got there. So if we move that, it gets in the way of unloading our cement and our fly ash, Then you have the trucks going over here loading and coming all the way back to wash down, then going back out. So that sounds good on paper, but it's just very inefficient. And in the whole scheme of things, it just does not work.
Mr. Queen, what position with the company did Mr. Canada occupy when he made the statements in 2009?
I don't know. I'm not sure.
Mr. Helms, the proposal that was, at one time was the proposal, I guess I'm looking over here on, dealing with when Boxley was, it was up for discussion. Obviously, that was all knocked down. Any idea, can you give me an approximation as to how close it was to the closest residential area?
Probably 300 or 400 yards.
And I guess I'm looking, if my math is correct, Jackson Street's not very long. And I guess, would it be correct to estimate that 1/4 of that would be the distance from the property line of the concrete company to the residential areas here with the, in regards to Chandler and the existing residential areas on Cambridge?
Say that again, please.
It's in 100 yards from there.
Yeah, it's about 1/4 that distance.
Yeah.
If that, it looks like it's even closer. I can't imagine Jackson Street's any more than probably 50 or 60 yards long. I could be wrong.
Well, the street's 50 feet wide, too.
That's good. Yeah. Good point. I guess I'm just trying to understand, because this is not my business, obviously. But protecting the community obviously is my business. And I'm asking, Mr. Canada made the statement that noise will be an issue for nearby homes, and if that's four times as far in 2009 with the Boxley proposal as the current conditions situated with Chandler Concrete in the current residential areas, can we reconcile the decibel readings that you have with the statements made by Mr. Canada, who occupied a position pretty high up with the company?
Yeah, I don't know what Mr. Canada said. I'm not.
Is he inaccurate with that statement?
I don't know. He's no longer with the company since I've been up here. I don't remember when he left the company, actually. It's been, I think, well over a year. But I don't know.
Would you like a copy of mine?
I'll be glad to.
I'm just one council member. We've heard some good information tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Shack spoke, but there are a number of residents here. Mm-hmm. I'll just throw something out on the table. I mean, I don't want to hurt business. I want to look out for other people. But we've heard good, I won't say arguments. We've heard good information from everyone here. I'm not being patronizing to say that. I can see both sides to this, and I am a civil engineer, and I understand the specs and so forth, and the ambitious projects that are underway in the area. But what I would like, I'll throw out there, is you said that you would go back. You saved all you can do. I've said that before, and the stakes are a little higher here with information. And again, Mr. Sack has spoken to several other residents here. I would suggest that maybe you go back and take what you've heard tonight and know that it's on our minds now. I mean, at least it's before us, and maybe give it a few weeks of consideration, 2 weeks or 4 weeks, and come back to us and let us know if there's anything else that can be done. Residences are here. Industrial property's been there since Moby Dick was a minnow. I mean, quite honestly. But like I said, there's been good information. And you want to be a good neighbor, and I'm not saying the monkey's on your back, but what I'm saying is you've heard this, and before we wash the baby out with the bathwater and, you know, take some kind of broad, you know, potentially some major action that could have a lot of collateral things that, you know, consequences, I would just suggest that maybe you take that under advisement and come back to us and report to us what else, you know, if indeed you want to be a good neighbor, maybe just come back and say, okay, we've talked and we've huddled up here and we heard what the neighbors have to say. And I guess the folks have supported what's been said tonight from Mr. Shack. Is that generally?
Not only night, I mean, you've dealt with night noises. There are daytime noises.
Well, and daytime, yeah, but anyway, I don't want to beat it, but I'm just going to, I would suggest that maybe you take that under advisement and maybe come back and tell us if there's anything else that you could do to
address this, and if not, that's fine too. I mean, we'll take that, and we'll have to decide. Each of us, there's several of us here, and I don't, you know, we haven't talked about it, but maybe that's an idea, is come back in 2 weeks or 4 weeks and give us an update and say, okay, we've talked, we've huddled up here, and this is what we're, you know. But anyway, I'd just throw that out there.
Have you as a company sat down and talked about this problem, or is this just from you? I mean, has everybody, all, everybody, the executives of this company sat down, had a meeting and say, hey, we've got this problem going on, what can we do to correct it?
Yes, Mr. Chandler's have, they've consulted with me, and we've talked, and...
And what did they say?
Well, right, that's when Andy and I met the first time a month or so ago, and, you know, trying to do some things to minimize it. It's just, you start talking about building sound barrier walls, it's very expensive, I'm sure. You know, as a company, you know, we're not, you know, making money. We're busy up here, but we're a large company. We're not busy everywhere else. You know, you start adding more expenses to, you know, stay in business, it just makes it tough, you know.
And I guess I'll just, on the surface, a little bit that I know, is it possible to have a strategic area where you would have a very limited barrier area that bounces, you know?
That's something we can certainly look at.
I mean, we're talking about building the Great Wall of China, but
right.
Maybe,
that'd be a whole other issue.
Maybe look at operate. I'm just throwing that out there. But I don't want to, you know, I don't want to cut your bait for you.
Mr. Queen, I'd echo what Brad said. I mean, let's see what options, if you go to your boss or the Chandlers and find out what options, you know, you can offer the neighbors in the town. And exactly what Brad said, I would like to see, you know, you work with them, whether it's some sort of procedure for sound buffering or...
huddle up and come back.
Exactly. We need to take this over as a council, but I'd rather let you see what your company can do about it.
I think one of the issues I heard when you were talking about the suggestion of moving something over so far out to load and coming back through, and one of the obstacles seemed to be that you know, they had to come back to another washing station.
Mm-hmm.
It would seem to me, in theory, that it would probably be a lot cheaper to run another water line and hook up another hose down where they are than it is to
it's not
be asked to build a retaining wall.
Right. In theory, you're right, but it's not a matter of just washing down the trucks. It's what we do with what comes off of it.
Right.
We have to maintain that. We're strict. We have strict guidelines that we have to adhere to from the EPA standpoint, stormwater standpoint, everything. So there's only a certain area that we've got designated where we can actually do that and control what's going on there so we don't have any, you know, environmental issues.
Mr. Quinn, how long do you think it would take to go back and have that meeting or to be able to discuss it with
you? I'll actually be in that area next week, so I will meet the next week.
Would this be something where we have a meeting of council on the 18th of this month? Would that provide you enough time to be able to at least get back some information to us?
That'll probably be tight.
Okay, the 2nd of October, I believe, would be the following meeting, which would be the first Tuesday, I think, in October. I could be wrong on the date.
I'll check on that, and I think I'm out of town on the 2nd of October, but I will check.
I think our next meeting would be October 2nd.
Well, if we cancel the 18th, go to the BML meeting?
Mm-hmm.
Right now, on the bottom agenda, I just saw it's the 18th.
We don't have a conflict with BML this year.
I think what he's trying to say is he'd like to say we could put you on the agenda, just so get something down right now. So and we can look forward to that, and so we don't have, well, we're going to do it later, we're going to do it a little later, you know, get something a little bit in concrete.
Right.
And frankly, Mr. Quinn, you're
stealing my thunder,
something in concrete.
And Mr. Quinn, just to echo what Mr. Showalter stated earlier, I think, you know, where I'm at, and I'm not trying to get into you. I don't understand this stuff, so I have questions about it.
Sure.
But what I'd like to, what would be nice is if council does not have to take action on that.
Right.
Is that it's just in the spirit of being a good neighbor, working together, working in conjunction with one another, that something can be decided and determined that would work out for everybody, and that'd be the end of it. If that way kind of takes it off our, that takes it off our hands, we'd like to make a decision on it, but that way gives basically you all an opportunity to work with the neighborhood, people you're going to be living next to.
Right.
Regardless, well, after council makes a decision on anything.
Well, another thing, just just so you know, until tonight, he's the only person I've had a complaint from. And we've actually had calls from other neighbors supporting us, so.
But you would, you don't truly feel, though, that other people don't have complaints, they just haven't voiced them to you? I mean, you don't think that's only one person has a complaint?
Well, I don't know, I mean, but we've had nobody come to us and, you know, say anything.
I think, I like the suggestion that they go take a look at it.
Sure.
Come back to us, and let's see if we can resolve this without council action.
What is your meeting after the second?
I'm not sure that I'm comfortable with 4 to 6 weeks.
Right.
I mean, I think really, if you have a scheduling conflict, then certainly your superiors in North Carolina know how to write a letter telling us what they propose to do.
Okay.
So I'd like to have something in writing much sooner than 6 weeks, which appeared to be the first time we could get this thing together.
Well, the first meeting in October is the second, which gives basically 28 days from today. The 18th would give 14. Which one do you think would work, Mr. Quinn, with 2 weeks being enough, or 4 weeks?
I know several are going to be out of town on the second. I'll see if they can draft something for that. What's the date after the second?
Probably the best thing to do, even if they're out of town, you will have had the meeting, you know what the...
I mean, you could have a spokesman come in here and spoke and all the things.
Sure. Or a letter sent to the town.
Yeah.
Sure. I mean, it's not that, we're not trying to ask all of you to change your schedules for us, but, you know, this is an issue that, quite frankly, I think is important. And I think that it's something that we need to know, and I realize that, you know, your hands are tied further down the road. But what we need to know from further down the road, are we going to work to stop this, help this, hinder this, or we're not going to do anything? Mm-hmm. Once we know that, then we know how to proceed.
It's the quicker we can get started on it.
Right. Let me ask one other question, and then I'll
go ahead.
And it's not along those lines. You have a decibel meter.
Yes.
And you measure the noise levels. Now, to put things in context, is it not true, and I may be wrong, that a 3 dB change in level either doubles or halves the volume? In other words, if you were getting a reading of 70 dB and you had a reading of 73 at another location, the volume would actually be twice. Or if you go the other direction, it's half. I think that's correct, because having worked in that area and doing things, so when you start comparing 69 and 72, there is a big difference,
okay,
is what I'm trying to say. You know, the volume may be twice at 72 as it is at 69, but check me out there.
Okay. Is it not, you're saying it's not a linear relationship?
It is not a linear relationship.
And, but anyway, you all are smart people and you know your business better than we do. You've heard it, and maybe you come back and you say there's nothing we can do. We know we've got clients. Give you a chance to huddle up and come back and see what happens.
Mr. Quinn, we appreciate, or Queen.
Queen.
Yeah. We appreciate your coming this evening, and as a representative or a spokesman for the company. You didn't get on the defensive. You didn't try to justify why you had the noise. You want to be a good neighbor, and I think Mr. Shack even appreciates that. Quite frankly, Mr. Shack, I think you've exercised some restraint for the last several weeks with this noise going on. I have a feeling if it had been me, I'd have been over there beating up on a truck or something.
Well, I try to do things right in my old age.
Except threatening the police chief, I don't think that's wise. That's up to you. That's a cross you got to bear.
All right. Well, thank you for coming. Is there anyone else that needs to address council at this time? Yes, sir.
Thank you. Anything else?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
He's got to change.
He's going to change the film on us in about...
All right, you'll just... You want to go ahead and change it now? Go ahead.
My name is Ken Hurley. I live at 500 Block Lane. If you look at your picture, you can see the white dot that's the water tower for the house that's right across the street from. Okay. Mr. Shack told me this paper...
If you look at the zoning map, you'll see his house is in the red...
500 block lane?
500 block lane. And I should apologize to Chandler Concrete, because this is the first time they're hearing a complaint from us, and that is not very neighborly, but this does seem like a good forum for it. To be clear on one thing, a jakebreak isn't simply just a downshifting. I have a Class B CDL for large trucks. It's even louder because it actually, it's almost like capping the exhaust, but much worse because it's much louder than that. And our bigger complaint is the speed and the noise from the trucks. Block lane is about a tenth of a mile long, 520 feet, and it's only 25 miles an hour, and that's where most of the speed and the noise comes from for us. So it's not just the mixing that goes on at the plant, it's the trucks themselves. And being, I was a bus driver for Blacksburg Transit as well, and being a training driver, I have some experience with different drivers, and I can tell them that it's the younger drivers that come flying in the most, the older drivers are the ones that polite and wave to us. But I really want to stress that, and it's the speed as well. It's very hard to control what subcontractors do. It can be much like herding cats. There's just no possibility. One thing that I would suggest is a sign on Cambria Street beforehand that says no jake brake, no exhaust brake. Can be called any, either thing, because that's really what's going to limit the noise for us. But to be sure, it's also the speed. At a tenth of a mile long, 25 miles an hour, it only takes about 13 seconds to go down that road, and plus there's a stop, or at least a yield at the very end of that. So some way to encourage the all drivers, including not the industrial drivers, to do the speed limit would be very beneficial for us, especially living right there, right at the intersection. And that's really what I wanted to say.
It'd be a good place to experiment with speed bumps, wouldn't it?
But to be sure, it's really speed and noise, not just the plant noise. I moved in well after the plant was built. So I signed up to live next to a concrete plant, not next to a speed bump. I thought about that, speed bumps. That would be a good idea, but please be careful if you decide to do that in your placement. If you put it right in front of our house, a loaded concrete truck can hold 36,000 to 40,000 pounds of concrete.
You're looking at 80,000 pounds.
The truck weighs another 40,000 pounds.
Maybe we ought to do speed ditches.
Either way, that thump
is might be louder.
That thump is going to knock some plates off the shelves.
All right, thank you, Mr. Hurley. Appreciate your comments.
And
the speeding is something that we can deal with. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's alert our police department to be in tune with that. Did you have anything else? I'm sorry.
As mentioned, you said a 3 decibel. It's 3 to 5 is a twice increase in sound. But on top of that, if you move twice as close to the noise, it's 4 times as loud. It's a simple law of physics. Mm-hmm. And we are 15 feet off the road. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Hurley.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to address council at this time? If not, then we'll close the citizens' hearing portion and move on to the discussion by mayor and council members. We have a proposed amendment to the employee handbook, and I'm going to ask Mr. Helms if he will address that.
Next, this is to clarify our handbook and give us a little bit more leeway. Right now, it says we can only do a background check on someone who's been offered a position. We'd like to be able to do it on people that are the finalists, the 3 or 4 finalists for a position, so that we can speed the process up and not offer somebody a job, do the background check, and find out that we have to reject them for some issue, and then it, you know, just delays us greatly. So that's the majority of this change. We're already doing the test. It's just like we'd like to be able to do it beforehand, before we offer it to the very final person, the final 2 or 3 that's coming for interviews, do it at that point.
We do it for every position, regardless of the level of the position.
Yes, sir. Yeah, we are.
That allows you to check if you've got 2 or 3 candidates and you're considering them, you can check all 3 of them and they're aware that you're doing this.
They have to sign a statement
and
permission form.
Does the statement say if they're considered a finalist or if you apply, you are subject to a background check at a certain point?
We just want to do the finalist. I'm not sure how she's worded it. Well, she hasn't worded a statement yet because we haven't
the new one because this hasn't passed.
I don't see a problem.
I didn't see a problem with the change in the handbook or the grant ordinance.
Has the attorney looked it over?
The attorney wrote the ordinance. Not this one, the other.
One in that case.
Under my direction. Mr. Hamm, just to make sure I understand, this ordinance already, obviously already exists. We did this way back before.
No.
And all you're going to do is update the language within that allows you to do the...
You need to update the ordinance.
Okay.
Do the ordinance.
And that's what I, and that's what I really ask that is, the, maybe it's me, but when you read the ordinance, the criminal background checks of applicants for town employment, but why don't we just have comprehensive background checks instead of criminal? Because frankly, 90% of what we got in here is nothing to do with criminal background checks. You've got an employee records, references, you've got license check, automobile insurance check, social service central register check, training experience check, personal references check, address check.
I think one of the things that you find if you are in an interviewing process out in the banking industry or anywhere else, you can't get a reference. Right. You can't call and say, was this guy a good employee? You can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the best you could do is he subject to be rehired? And then you don't have to answer it. So, you know, I think that in one, if I'm going to use somebody as a reference, I'm going to be pretty darn sure they're going to give me a good reference. So I think a secondary choice is this background thing may be the deciding point.
I think the question Mr. Hall had was a little different.
Yeah, the reason I was saying is I just didn't want to be misleading, because frankly what we're talking about is not a criminal background check. We're talking about a criminal background check in addition to, it's really a comprehensive background check, because again, for instance, social services, central register check, you're checking for CPS backgrounds, CPS child complaints, founded level complaints, things like that. Nothing to do with criminal law at all. That is outside the completely outside. That's not beyond reasonable doubt. There is no criminal sanction. There's nothing. There's just, but there is a sanction when it comes to trying to find employment with CPS issues. And I mean, only two of them that I see that deal with criminal records and criminal background fingerprint checks. I just didn't want to be, we didn't want to put Mr. Helms in the position of where we got this, we have this ordinance drafted. And they're like, well, wait a minute, I read criminal background check, but what are you talking about the CPS checks? What are you doing that for? Because frankly, it might not have any bearing on certain types of positions and things. All of us asking, and I'm fine with the way it's written. I'll defer to the council, but if it just says comprehensive background check of applicants, everything's included. And if you know what, if you decide you want to do one and not do the other, that's up to your prerogative. I would just throw that out there. Because part of that comprehensive background check is the criminal background aspect of it. It's an element of it.
Would criminal include driving records? So if we're hiring, if we have someone in consideration that's going to be using company vehicles extensively, the background check would reveal any speeding tickets, DUIs?
I think what he's saying, a background check would, but a criminal background check only covers criminal things.
Right.
So if we take out the criminal or change that to comprehensive, is what he's suggesting.
In other words, it's all encompassing, and then it's
comprehensive includes.
Yeah, that's what he's saying.
And right now, if you look in that section B,
background check.
Right now it says criminal background check, but if you look in section B, it says the criminal history record information, blah, blah, may include the following, employment records/employee references. Well, that's not criminal background check. Then it says criminal background records information, criminal background check, fingerprint. Then it says driver's license check, which is not criminal, automobile insurance check, which is not criminal, social services central register check, not criminal, training experience check, not criminal, personal references address check, not criminal. I was just trying to make it more concise to where, frankly, someone can't come back in and say, well, wait a minute, why in the world would you check that? You said criminal background check. I just assumed that was criminal background check. And frankly, some of those other things are as important as a criminal background check, especially that social services registry check. But I just throw it out there. Again, I think it's well written regardless, and I'm fine with the way it is. I just want to put it out there. Only thing when I read it, the only thing that jumped out at me was
It includes that, but it just doesn't say
no.
Compromises.
You discourage criminals from applying.
You'd be surprised.
Yeah.
Jim, can you think of anything, any issue, change it to comprehensive?
Well, the concern that we had was you don't want to give the impression that you're going to do this in every occasion because it's expensive.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And the minute you pick and choose, you better make sure you pick and choose for a very valid reason, or you're going to be accused of discriminating for an invalid reason.
But we've already got that language in there, may.
Right.
So source and may include the following, so we already are kind of saying in some situations that we would do all these and others we would not.
Do you go back in and say all finalists under consideration?
We have said that.
We do. There's two. The police do a more comprehensive check than for Public Works, and Parks and Recreation does more comprehensive than Public Works. I guess police is the strictest, and then everybody else gets one that covers most things, but it's not quite as...
But this is Mr. Gwynn's bailiwick. I'll defer to him. I mean, this is not
the thing. The key word here is consistency.
Right.
Whether it specifically say criminal background check and other comprehensive checks, I don't know. But I think the fact that if it's felt that we need to pull the background check, one, as Barry said, to speed up the process, and two, it's probably a good thing to have.
Do we just call it background checks?
We're doing a number of different things, or we can do a number of different things that before you even get to this point. Because what you want to try and do is make sure that you can do as much of this without expense as possible. For example, requiring folks to sign a release that allows you to get their employment records from previous employers. That may take care of it. You know, you may not go any further. So, I mean, these are often done in steps. I think criminal history is done on almost every occasion. Like Barry says, you know, it's done in more detail depending on the, you go further depending on the department. The reason that it was labeled criminal background check is because we wanted to be able to do it for everybody when they became a finalist. But we may not do the others. And so I understand where you're coming from when you say, gosh, I saw that I was having a criminal history check done. I didn't realize you were going to do this other thing. Chances are we're not. So I think if you put in that there's going to be a comprehensive check, I mean, you also have the possibility of discouraging employees.
Do we not have a, Mr. Gwynn said, we have a criminal background check. We use a CCRA. We use it probably for every single person that applies, don't we?
I'm sorry.
Every single person that makes, either gets down as a finalist or is considered for employment. We always
have to start doing national background checks. We were just doing local background checks, police checks.
Right. And so we're going to be doing that regardless. So anyway.
I could see the wording because it says criminal history record and it comes says may include the following
right.
And all the other stuff. And that's in the ordinance. But the thing that the potential employee is going to see is the handbook. So similar language should be used in the handbook also.
Well, they probably aren't going to see the handbook. They're probably just going to be handed the release to sign.
Well, but a lot of times when you interview people, you give them the information, you know, if you were a company,
right.
They're evaluating you, or if you, and you, the town where they're evaluating, so you would give them the handbook so they know what their benefits are going to be and stuff like that. So I think...
You could, but I think what we do on our applications is to put in a statement that's going to be a check on there.
Again, when I read that section B, though, when it says the criminal history record information, that we'll get that through the central records or other appropriate qualified private source, and it may include the following. I just don't know how we get anything criminal record related from employment records, social security checks, social services checks, liability insurance checks, driver's license checks. I don't see how. There's no way we can get anything criminal related at all through those checks.
There shouldn't be.
No, but there's just nothing there. There wouldn't be anything there.
Yeah.
I just want to, maybe we want to have a provision that based on the criminal record, background check and information and the criminal background check and fingerprint is going to be done, and then another section says and further comprehensive check may include a further check of your comprehensive check of your background may include the following,
yeah,
including but not limited to the following employment records.
Yeah, that sounds good.
But let us go and look at it and change the language.
Well, do you think it needs to be changed, though? Or do you think it is okay the way it is?
I think it's fine the way it is.
Okay.
I'm with the council. It's not my,
But I agree with Mr. Hall because those things down there, you're not going to find the criminal stuff. But those are some of the things you might want to look at.
Right.
for particular individuals.
This is not something we have to act on.
I'd like to see him go back.
Don't we have some of that language on the application itself?
Yes.
In lieu of.
I mean, they'll never see the ordinance. They probably, I mean, I don't really give a handbook to anybody when we, when they turn in an application. They get that after they're offered the job.
In processing usually.
So, I mean, what they see is, like Mr. Showalter says, it's on the application, which says, you know, we're gonna do this check.
Yeah, but if they give a copy of this, and this is their ordinance, and this is our handbook, shouldn't it be consistent with?
I think it is.
Well, but from the standpoint, it shouldn't be something above and beyond what the application has.
Well, the application has criminal background check, and if you wanna know what that is, then if you're that interested in knowing what it is, then you need to go look at the handbook and you need to go look at the ordinance.
Take a look at it.
All right, let's let Jim take this back and clean it up, revise it.
Bring it back to saying whatever.
Come back to us. All right, let's move along. Proposed commercial alarm registration and false alarm ordinance. We did have a meeting on the July the 29th, I believe it was, and the committee is gathering information, and they will be coming back again to us with a recommendation. This is just to give you an update that the committee is still working.
Is a fantastic.
That was August the 29th, wasn't it?
The meeting was.
Was it August or September?
Last Wednesday morning, 7:30.
I guess it was, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the individual that, you all knew, the.
Bill?
Yeah. He's fantastic. Yeah.
Okay, so everybody showed up, that was.
Oh, we had a great group of all of us there, but Bill was, he's pretty well versed.
You know, the thing wasn't there, and it was his turn to buy breakfast. I don't, I'll just take $3 and eat off you in the morning, Dick.
Moving right along.
All right, moving right along. Council to set the personal property tax relief percentage at 40.54% is required by the Personal Property Tax Relief Act. Council must set the personal property relief percentage each year.
I move that we do it.
Second.
The proposal is for 40.54%. Ms. Tweedy calculated using the formula the state told us we'd use. So.
We've already, let's do it. We got to go.
Okay.
No, we don't have an option to go any higher, lower, or indifferent, so yeah.
I hear a motion.
Yes.
Motion and a second.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
To adopt this personal property relief percentage of 40.54%. Discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed, no. Motion carries. Mr. Stipes, Mr. Van Hoosier.
Life's as simple as it gets. The plat that the street committee reviewed that's before you this evening is a lot line vacation off of Rose Hill Drive, which is off of South Franklin Street, just before you get to Overland. The sketch shows lot 15A, the internal lines that are dashed are being vacated, and our staff is not able to do more than one lot line vacation, is that correct? And the, not that it matters, but the purpose of it is the house, you know, may be replaced, and since there's a different lot line there, this is tidying up the situation for the homeowner. So the street committee has reviewed it, and it is conformant. It's in conformance with our subdivision ordinance, and the street committee's recommendation is to approve the plat as presented. And that recommendation, I'll make in the form of a motion.
I'll second it.
A motion and a second. Any discussion on this matter?
Obviously, Mr. Stipes, we mean the big, large dash lines, correct? I was looking at it too close. I was like, that asphalt driveway.
Like 15A
Right. Now there's three little...
Both lawyers over here.
You got the lawyer interpreting that for you?
No, we were both looking at it the same way. That's a funny looking lot.
That's a crazy lot.
There's no further discussion. All in favor of this recommendation by the street committee, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carries. Anything else, street committee?
Really, we're taking a look at Well Oak Street, or they're still...
Give a quick update. Yeah, I think we are still getting traffic data on that, right?
Yes.
Okay, we'll wait for a final update for council on that. We're looking at a request that's been made to study the traffic operations on Roanoke Road at the industrial park, Christiansburg Industrial Park. And we've heard about that during rezonings, or not rezonings, but people
for that. Near the Waffle House on Roanoke Road.
Correct.
How about Franklin Street Waffle House, the new one? Was it Cord?
It was. Then right across from Trinity Baptist Church.
Yeah.
With Waffle House.
We're still gathering the traffic counts on that.
Thank you.
I'm sure. All right.
Okay.
We have a request for a closed meeting under Virginia Code Section 2.237.11A3 for the discussion or consideration of the acquisition of real property for public purposes. When discussion in an open meeting would adversely affect the bargaining position or the negotiating strategy of the public body, the purpose of the closed meeting is to discuss the purchase of property.
So moved.
And a motion to go into closed session.
Got it.
Motion and a second. All in favor, please say aye.
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 And then poll council. And then poll council. Steve, wait a minute.
I'm just going to close the school.
I got to get out.
All right, Madam Chairman, or Madam Clerk, poll council, please. I'm lost.
Councilman Barber.
Aye.
Councilman Hall.
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard.
Aye.
Councilman Showalter.
Aye.
Councilman Stipes.
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier.
Aye.
All right, we'll be in closed session. We need to take about a 3 or 5 minute break here. 2 hours.
Let me go. When we come out, bearings. I need to check the door.
I move to certify that the town council of the town of Christiansburg, meeting in closed meeting, in the best of each member's knowledge, discussed only public business matters, lawfully exempt from open meeting requirements by Virginia law, and only such matters as are identified in the resolution to enter into closed meeting.
That is a motion.
Second.
Ms. Clerk, please poll council.
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber.
Aye.
Councilman Hall.
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard.
Aye.
Councilman Showalter.
Aye.
Councilman Stipes.
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier.
Aye.
Now we're out of closed session. Town manager's report.
You have the bills. I'll try to answer any questions.
Everybody have a copy of the bills?
Yeah. About 7.
I move that we pay the bills.
Second.
Motion to pay the bills in a second. Discussion. All in favor of paying the bills, let's say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carries. Mr. Helms, pay the bills.
Need to set 2 public hearings. Need to do them separately, please. There's a request for a street vacation, unbuilt portion of Locust Street adjoining 1270 Radford Street. It's 25 feet in width. Approximately 183 feet long, and we can have that on the 2nd of October.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Hold a public hearing on October 2nd. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed, no.
A request for rezoning on Somerset Drive. We can have that one on the 16th of October. Didn't ask Nicole what it was from and to, so.
Yeah. You know. That's our residential, or is that towards 114?
The lot immediately behind the West the I Center there,
mm-hmm.
Corner of Somerset and very right.
And they're asking for a public hearing for?
For the 16th of October.
To do what?
For rezoning.
Is that the Curtis Mathis?
Was Curtis Mathis.
Oh, okay.
All right, have a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor of setting this public hearing October the 16th, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
Wouldn't mind having Nicole choose something that just says this is what they're asking to do, from to, just a little bit of food for thought.
Planning Commission will have their public hearing the 24th of September.
Yeah, we haven't heard this yet.
I'll find out next time.
What else, Mr. Hamm?
Laid the Hunkberry Trail progress update in each of his place. The major changes from the last time, phase 2C is the asphalt has been awarded to Norwood Construction, and hopefully they'll start a little sooner than the 4 weeks it's on there, but it has been awarded. And phase 2A, I'm sorry, back up second one. Hopefully the VDOT told us that they'd send an authorization for advertisement to the central office tomorrow for approval. Hopefully we'll get that back in 2 or 3 weeks, maybe sooner than that. Won't promise anything sooner than that.
Who's advertising that? Is the town advertising that?
Well, we can't advertise until they give us permission to advertise.
Right.
Yeah,
the town will be administering that?
Yes. Through the county's T21 project,
right.
NML and town are working on that. And that's the major changes from last time.
A couple questions since John is here. I'm glad you are. Phase 2E, which is for council, is the further extension of the trail is under construction now on down Cambria Street that will make a connection to the Huckleberry Trail extension there. What is the funding being used for that? Is that revenue sharing or?
Yes, sir.
Is not T money?
No, sir.
It's no federal money? Why is it waiting for a VDOT environmental review? It doesn't need that. If it's less than $500,000.
Our understanding from VDOT when we discussed it with them is that because all of these trail pieces are linking together and that this piece of the trail would provide a bridge from one to the other.
I got it. Okay.
Yeah.
And the other thing is the environmental review for those, like you say, all of them. We're doing everything we can do. I know VDOT is, I know that's underway. And the last thing, the crossing of the railroad track, which will join, is between 2A and 2B. Are we acquiring the easement from Hash Investments? Has that been done?
It's not been done yet, that's right.
What's the holdup on that? I'm sorry. So that's underway.
I've been negotiating with them. We've got an estimate.
The crossing itself of Norfolk Southern tracks could be a holdup too, because it has to be engineered.
Yes, sir. Okay. Actually, Norfolk Southern would have their own consultant engineer the actual crossing of the Norfolk Southern right away.
Okay.
And their gentleman that's working on that, Mr. Overby from Atlanta, he has so much limited time. He covers a pretty large area. He had committed to us, made a priority, the phase 2A right of entry agreement. And that's what we just got completed back from them today. And so now he's moving on to doing the Gobbler Spur crossing. And that's the next thing on his list for our area.
Okay. So the easement and everything is just part of clearing the right of way. But that crossing of railroad tracks, I guess hopefully that won't hold up if we get the environmental clearance and plans approved and everything for 2B, but that railroad crossing.
No, sir, I don't think so.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
John, I see this, that the engineering is reviewing various bridge drawings. I sort of thought that had already been accepted, and what is the status? We still thinking next spring?
Yes, sir. My best understanding of the VDOT's working with the contractor on their schedule is that the bridge, because we are reviewing shop drawings from them, and those shop drawings are kind of, they take the plans and then they have their subcontractor put together what they're gonna actually build in the field, and they send that to us, and we match that or verify that versus the plans themselves, and then we accept their shop drawings. So them working on those shop drawings now, we anticipate that that would be this coming summer construction.
Oh, next summer?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Now, before VDOT agreed to build the bridge, did we select the design, we were gonna do the bridge?
Yes, sir, that got incorporated into those plans.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
The shop drawings is more of the detail, how they're gonna hook each piece together, and what materials, exact materials you're gonna use, and that kind of stuff.
But the design that we approved is gonna be basically the same?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. It's good to know. All right, anyone else, Mr. Helms?
Probably contacting the finance committee probably this week to see if we can schedule a meeting to talk about water billing practices. Came up a couple of meetings ago from Mr. Cheadle. Virginia Municipal League is the 20th, Sunday the 23rd. Do the by the 25th, come back the 26th. If anybody would like to ride with me, I'll be going down. I'll need to leave about 8 o'clock on Sunday morning because I have a 2 o'clock workshop to attend. And I'll be coming back on Wednesday. But if you'd like to ride with me, let me know.
Okay.
Is anyone planning to come back on Monday?
I'm gonna come back Tuesday afternoon.
Okay. I probably won't go down by myself, but I'll put council on notice. I've had a big commitment come up that's gonna make me need to come back Monday. It's the design public hearing for the 81 bridges over the river next to 105. It's $100 million. I got a design public hearing for that. This is my project, so I have to come back on Monday. If no one else is coming back on Monday, then I'm not sure if I'm gonna go or not.
Okay.
It's all answered.
Okay. All right, thank you, Mr. Helms.
Can I ask one question, Mr. Ballinger?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Helms, just about backing up with Mr. Cheadle, in regards to the water billing practices, just to refresh my memory, those are not individually billed there at his location. That's one master bill, basically, is the way it works.
Yes.
That doesn't have those individuals on each of his units, correct?
Correct.
3 meters.
Okay.
Or 90, around 90 units.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, he's not the only trailer park that this would be.
And apartment complexes also.
Apartment complexes. Mm-hmm. Okay, VDOT has requested that we appoint a representative from the town to serve on the corridor study for Route 11, 460, and Route 8. And that's going to be an ongoing committee that will be working on that over the next couple of years. They're suggesting that we have an elected official to serve on that. It doesn't have to be, but I think it would do us well to have a representative from council to serve on that committee. If you're interested, let me know, and if not, then sometime between now and October, we'll try to get somebody appointed.
Pick a name out of the hat.
Yeah, we'll pull a name out of the hat. But if you're interested in highway construction and all of those things, that the ramification of it, you might be interested in this committee. All right.
We had, Barry, I didn't get a real chance to scan it. Did you send council an email concerning the recent rec department appointee that Beeler, I think's his name?
Yeah, Joey Beeler.
Yeah, he has accepted a job at Davidson College, so he's going to turn down, he's going to have to decline our request, our invitation. So I talked to Brad Epperly, and he has had a couple other people that have been interested. I was asking him to go ahead and formulate some info on.
Yeah, we'll be reappointing someone, or we'll be appointing someone to take his place, even though he hasn't served yet. I suggested to you that we have a resolution for Carmen Graves. She's a young lady that grew up here in Christiansburg, and she has been an outstanding track star at Roanoke College, and she was selected as Athlete of the Year for ODAC. Mm-hmm. And I'm gathering information now, and we'll do a resolution, and then as she progresses next year and still gets all these accolades, we'll do something in the form of a certificate for the next time, like we do with the high school kids. Let's see. There's a ribbon cutting on September the 13th, and this will be at 1715 Pratt Drive. It's the Lewis Gale Physicians Clinic that they have there in the Virginia Tech Corporate Park. And it's going to be a big boon to folks with medical needs in that area. So you're invited to attend that at 10 o'clock if you'd like to attend that ribbon cutting. Anything else to come before council? Just mention that Ron Rordham and I will be conducting the Eggs and Issues program on Thursday morning at the Holiday Inn. And it's more or less an update or kind of like a State of the Union address. He's going to do one for Blacksburg, and I'm going to do one for Christiansburg.
So keep good notes.
If you'd like to attend that, that'll be at 8 o'clock at the Holiday Inn in here in Christiansburg. Anything else?
Just one question. Mr. Wingfield, the CUPs online, that is completed, correct?
It is not posted yet. The planning department's done with the work, but they're working with the computer consultant to have them posted. So it should be within a week or so.
In a week.